time become death, the destroyer of worlds.
The only thing we have to fear is...
Well, when the president does it, that means that it is not illegal.
Epic fails of history.
Today we're joined by Devin Clark.
Hey, how's it going? I'm actually excited. This is the first time I've been a guest on a podcast.
Yeah, so it's worth mentioning that Devin is the host of the Pretend Radio podcast. He's actually the one that really introduced me into podcasting in the first place, back in the day, you know, early on with the blog and all that.
Early on when you were doing the blog, we were guests on Devin's podcast, and both of us kind of really took a liking to it, I guess. Based off, like, you know, the experience that we had over doing his show. And I think that kind of led us to want to do something like this.
Starting our own. I meant to start a podcast like years ago, and it just never got off the ground for one reason or another. So we finally got this show going. And I was like, well, we got to have Devin on at some point.
Yeah.
You know, like, that was priority number one. So I'm glad we're finally able to get together and record this.
Yeah, we've been talking about doing this for a long time. But, you know, with everyone's schedule and, you know, just how life plays out.
Finds a way.
Sometimes it takes a while, but I'm glad we're doing this, and I'm stoked to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, thank you for coming. So, Devin, thank you for being here.
Devin, there's a question we like to ask every guest that we have, and we've got some really good answers so far, and I know that your answer was fantastic, but we like to ask, what do you think is either the most epic or one of the most epic fails in history?
Oh, okay. So, Centralia, Pennsylvania, I think is a fascinating, story. Apparently it's to this day and since what, the 50s, 60s?
1962.
It's basically this town that basically a underground coal mine is still smoldering to this day. And everyone had to, you know, basically evacuate. It's basically a condemned city besides maybe a few people who decided, you know.
To sit
It's basically an underground fire that's been burning for almost 60 years.
Just
now.
Smoldering, yeah.
There's like cracks in the street. It looks like hell's trying to escape.
Yeah, it looks like, what was that crappy movie, like Dante's Inferno?
Dante's Inferno, yeah, or Volcano.
Yeah, yeah, it looks
Pierce
like that.
Pierce Brosnan was in that one?
Pierce Brosnan was in Dante's Inferno, yeah. Tommy Lee Jones is in Volcano.
I just think it's fascinating, like, I'm kind of fascinated by abandoned places, you know, in ghost town. What happened here?
Yeah.
This is crazy. I mean, the more you read about this city, the crazier it gets. I mean, they're still not even 100% sure how the fire started. They think maybe it might have been because they were burning a landfill that had, I guess at some point in the ground, there were some cracks that led down into the, what they say is a labyrinth of coal mines. And that when they were burning the dump, that fire got down into the coal and started it. And once that fire started down there, I mean, it's just never going to stop burning, basically. And all but seven people have been forced out. And those seven people actually made a deal with the government saying, you know, if you don't kick us out, we'll just kind of be here alone. And then when we die or whatever, you know, our property falls under eminent domain. And
which
the government
I can't imagine that would be good for your health to be living on top of a smoldering coal mine.
I mean, I guess it's the same mentality of the people that are like, I ain't scared of no hurricane when everyone, it's like a mandatory evacuation.
But it is a really crazy story, especially just how did something go so terribly wrong that now this entire area, the entire town is condemned.
Yeah, it's unlivable. It's actually, like you said, it's actually been condemned.
Yeah.
By the state of Pennsylvania. It's like unlivable.
It's just like, we're not building here. We're not doing anything. This is like, we screwed up.
I mean, what do you even do with that? Once the fire goes out in 100 years or whatever, what,
yeah. And I mean, I don't
just blow it up and make a huge hole in the ground and fill it in with all the.
I don't know the size, you know, of this coal mine, but I mean,
it sounds pretty massive.
It has to be if it's been just smoldering for this long.
And smoldering, people might get the wrong image. Mm. It is smoldering. It's not like actively, like it's not big inferno or anything like that. But it is still on fire. Like the heat is still
there's still
rising.
There's still smoke and gases coming up through the streets, like you said.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they filmed Silent Hill there or something. One of the Silent Hill.
I think the town was the one of the inspirations.
Oh, that's what it was.
Not sure if they actually. I don't think you can film anything.
Yeah, I think it's kind of Chernobyl. Like,
I think the air's got to be toxic at this point. I mean, it's got to be really.
I can't
toxic.
Imagine. I mean, just all those gases and
coal. I mean. Yeah. You've seen Zoolander, you know about the clean black coal. Clean coal, yeah. So that's a good answer, though. We've got some interesting ones. I like that one a lot. And
I don't know. That one just kind of, you know, I was thinking about it, and I was like, okay, they've covered this, they've covered that, and that just popped in my mind, and I was like, that's a pretty terrible mess up.
What's really funny is an episode I was recording the other day, I actually got asked the question myself, and I just wasn't prepared for it, oddly enough. Like, I've been asking everyone else. I didn't really think of it myself. I was like, oh, there's so much. There's so many candidates.
So we got a couple things we want to go over today.
Yeah, today's sort of a random hodgepodge.
It's almost a grab bag. Yeah. The first one I want to talk about is just because it's so ridiculous. It's one of those things where you read about it and you go, are you kidding me? But at the same time, of course, that's a thing. And you can actually read more in detail about it in Eric's Epic Fails book with Ben Thompson, The Race to Space, the second book in the series. It's really great. That's correct. I highly recommend doing so. So anyway, the corned beef sandwich incident occurred on March 23rd, 1965. And we go back to NASA's Project Gemini. So it's Project Gemini, which took place between Mercury and Apollo programs.
Good 1600. Eagle looking great. Roger 1202, we copy it.
And the astronauts in question here, Gus Grissom and John Young. And if you know your NASA history, these guys are, you know, these are famous
pretty big
astronauts.
Names.
These
are,
Gus Grissom in particular.
Well, he had already been in space at that point in the Mercury program.
So anyway, the two of these guys were launched into orbit. They're on the Gemini 3. It's a little tiny. The Gemini program, for those who don't know, the shuttles weren't very big. They're pretty cramped.
No, these are like OG astronauts.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, it's the timestamp of this at 1 hour, 52 minutes, and 26 seconds. So they know exactly when this happened. But that long into the mission, John Young pulls out a contraband item he'd smuggled on board the ship without authorization, a corned beef sandwich.
Now that you mention it, I've actually heard of this. And it's hilarious. They're like, no.
The Simpsons, of course, parodied it with the ridges will clog the instruments. So the two begin to, you know, Gus Grissom, who should know better, they share the sandwich. Yeah, this is great. We're eating a corned beef sandwich in zero G. Unfortunately, the zero G part really kicked in. The sandwich immediately began to crumble apart.
In all directions.
You take a bite of a sandwich, how many crumbs fall off the sandwich? But you're eating it over a plate, you're standing outside or something.
Or with gravity.
Yes.
On Earth.
So those crumbs fall down as opposed to go everywhere. Yeah. So the crumbs and pieces of sandwich in the zero-G environment nearly jeopardize the entire mission as free-flying sandwich particles threaten to clog or short out onboard equipment. Now, if you know anything about these old shuttles, you know how your margin of error is like if you mess up anything, you're dying. There's course correction.
So many variables.
There's
so many
no course correction. Especially on the Gemini and the Mercury programs. We're just kind of throwing you out there to see what happens. We're not at Apollo yet where they have, you know, ground controls really on their game yet. Yeah. This is still early on. Yeah. So this is such a big deal that a congressional committee even held a hearing over the incident and both the astronauts were reprimanded. Like, you don't take a corned beef sandwich.
It's almost an international incident.
It's like, we've been through this. First of all, I don't know why you think that would be a good idea to bring a corned beef sandwich. And,
I brought this puzzle. Let's put it together.
It's like here's my bucket of Legos.
Yeah, when I first read about this in a textbook, I was doing research for the book, and I had not heard about it. I was like, what is this?
Yeah,
it's like I had to put it in the book. I actually made room for a chapter just on this subject.
I honestly know, like, I'm harping on this way too much. I think it's really funny that Gus Grissom is one of these guys, because this dude had been to space and back at this point. He should know better than eat a sandwich in a zero-G environment in an enclosed space full of sensitive equipment. I don't get it, man. It's like standing in front of an open fire, like, watch me juggle these flimsy bottles of gasoline.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's one of those things that, especially with that amount of training, that amount of expertise, that you should know that it's a terrible idea.
Yeah, it just goes to show that everybody's a moron at some point, right?
Well, you know, maybe it's just one of those things where it's like, if I'm dying out of space, I'm eating a corned beef sandwich. Because especially you said it was the Gemini program.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
There was no guarantee back then. I mean, there still isn't, but.
Oh, yeah, true.
I mean, it's a lot better than it was then.
Yeah.
So it's just like, if I'm going out, if I'm not coming back to Earth, I'm going to have a corned beef sandwich.
Enjoy my sandwich.
Yeah, exactly.
So if you have followed me on the Pretend Radio Instagram, you might know that I am a huge fan of instant noodles. It's a strange, weird world of delicious and god-awful flavors. And sometimes you never know what you're going to get. But a while back in Georgia, a group of thieves hijacked a truck carrying $89,000 worth of ramen noodles. Yes, ramen noodles. What you do with that, I'm not quite sure.
$89,000? So that's got to be like what? Like a million?
They should point out too, this is 2018 that this happened. This is
this happened a few months ago.
So, and I want to point out something else too. You got $90,000 of ramen noodles. Do you have any idea, for those of you who actually have money and don't eat ramen noodles?
20 cents a block.
20 cents a pack. You can buy five for a dollar. Five for a dollar. Multiply that by 90,000+.
Yeah.
That's like three trucks worth of ramen noodles.
Yeah. So how many units?
Oh, who knows? I'm sure someone could do the math, and it's probably quite a lot. My thing is though,
why?
Because they're so cheap, unless you just like, I'm sick of paying for noodles and like that's all you want to eat for the rest of your life, in which case, yeah, okay, you just fed yourself for free forever. Otherwise, what the like? Think about it. You can sell them at a store for 20 cents.
I can buy like 30 right here.
Right. You sell them at a store for 20 cents, so you're not selling them as an individual for less than 20 cents.
What do you do with them?
The economy's not that bad.
So maybe you sell them for 10 cents a piece. So you made what, $9,000? Like, yeah, that's awesome. But you're gonna risk your freedom for $9,000 worth of noodles.
So how many federal crimes were
for $9,000 worth of ramen?
And also, is it one of those things like when
they're still at large?
Oh, they never got caught.
As far as I know,
yeah. I mean, there's not like a lowjack on ramen.
I'm not advocating hijacking 18-wheelers, but
that's pretty.
That's kind of awesome. Yeah.
When I saw the headline, I was like, "Oh, what's Devin been up to?"
You guys want some soup?
He was like, "I'm really poor."
I mean, that's just insane.
It is crazy.
And is that one truck? They were able to fit almost $100,000 of ramen truck.
I mean, if you think about it, it's like
it's pretty small. You can probably fit a few hundred in a box. So
yeah, especially if you have a giant, you know, 18-wheeler packed to the brim.
Yeah, apparently but the truck was sitting at a gas station overnight, and someone was like,
"So I wonder." So it's sitting at a gas station.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, I wonder if they're like, what could be in this truck?
Yeah, did they know jewels it was noodles, and diamonds? Or did they rob it? Like, did they take it? Like, we're about
they might not have known.
We're about to be so rich, you guys. I bet this thing's full of TVs.
Yeah.
Ramen. Instead of full of PS1s.
Like, yeah. You know, just like
Crash Bandicoot copies.
Not the retro. Crash Bandicoot copies probably worth some money.
No.
Not the retro PS1, like used PS1s.
And then they finally get to like their stash house and they open it up and it's like, oh, sweet. Marchan chicken ramen that you can get at Publix.
Yeah, it's the shrimp flavor. They're like, ah.
It's like, I'm allergic to shrimp.
Well, if one of them was gluten free, man.
It's like, what could you possibly do with that?
I don't even like soup.
You know, there's some crime that is just so funny that it's just like,
feed poor college.
It's like, you can get away with it. Like, that's just so ridiculous. Like,
all right, fine. So, Eric, I know you wanted to talk about the curse of the Willy Dee.
This story, man, this is insane. I originally thought of doing an article on it. I was like, let's just put it in the podcast. So, the USS William D. Porter, this was back in World War II, was an American destroyer with perhaps the worst track record in the history of the Navy. Back in November 1943, the Willy Dee was tasked with escorting a battleship, the USS Iowa, across the Atlantic on a top-secret mission to escort President Franklin Delano Roosevelt to a conference with Winston Churchill and Joseph Stalin.
So obviously not like super important or anything.
Like, no big deal.
It's only World War we're talking about here.
So while leaving dock, the porter's anchor nearly took out a nearby ship. The ship's railings, lifeboat mounts, the captain's gig, and other equipment were ripped completely off the other ship. And this was just an omen of things to come.
Oh boy.
On their way to North Africa, escorting the Iowa under radio silence, they were on the lookout for German U-boats. When all of a sudden, without warning, there was a massive boom. The explosion created a large tidal wave that slammed into the porter, nearly capsizing it and completely knocking a sailor overboard, never to be seen again. For a split second, the convoy assumed they were under attack and began defensive maneuvers. Well, that is until they realized that a depth charge had simply rolled off of the deck of the Willy Dee.
Jesus Christ.
Now, so at what point do you realize it was like, oh, that was me?
Maybe you didn't roll.
Like,
maybe
who didn't strap this thing?
Maybe you guys would have. Like, I'm jumping, bro. Taking my chances with the sharks.
What's crazy is that's not the last thing to happen with this week on the ship.
There's more. Oh,
this is all within the same few days.
So with the depth chart, did it the boat up, or was it?
Yeah, so the resulting wave not only knocked off anything that wasn't strapped down, the boiler room flooded and the ship lost power because this happened. A couple days later, FDR asked to see what the fleet was capable of, so the Iowa released some balloons in the air for target practice, you know, drills and stuff. So the Willy Dee began running torpedo drills. It aimed its guns at the Iowa. Like, you know,
like
test
you do,
firing.
Aim your gun at your allies for no reason at all.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of like,
I guess maybe like testing, like lining up practice. The guns, make sure the sights work and everything like
well,
that.
Well, yeah, it's kind of like when you're cleaning your shotgun, you just point at your friend's face.
President Cheney.
So,
President Cheney.
Oh, we're keeping it in.
So aims his guns at the Iowa.
Yeah, the primers were removed from the torpedoes, except for on the third shot.
So wait, when you say that, when they remove the primer, that's like,
that's what actually,
basically, when you remove the primer, what that means is essentially now you're shooting like a dead, like a dud. You're shooting like a practice shot or a squib or whatever.
They pretty much go through all the maneuvers that would be involved in actually firing,
but without
combat,
lethal,
without actually firing the torpedo.
So you said they did it all but once?
So on the third shot, the practice order was given. A live armed torpedo shot across the water towards the USS Iowa. This is the ship that has the president on board.
Oh my god. Oh, you're so fired. Oh no.
It's like, oh no.
This
is
not like the FDR was beloved or anything like that. She shot the invisible swordsman.
The entire crew of the USS Porter at this point went into complete pandemonium as they attempted to signal the Iowa without using their radios, because they're under radio silence. They don't know if there's German subs.
They're waving around this ship.
So they're like, hey! Throwing up flares, you know, trying to get the other ship's attention from like who knows how far away.
So no one has any idea what's going on at
this point. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The entire ship's panicking. How did this happen? And the other ship didn't get the message. They were forced to break radio silence, and the Iowa got the message in the nick of time. Luckily. FDR and the Secret Service watched from above deck as the torpedo harmlessly streaked by. In fact, FDR actually asked to be rolled to the edge of the ship to get a better look. As a kid,
I love
FDR,
he's awesome.
So now the entire convoy's guns are aimed at the Willy Dee. They don't know if there's a saboteur aboard. They don't know if it's the Russians. Like, something's going on with it.
Just nobody could possibly
how
this incompetent.
Just utter chaos.
This is nuts. Like, this is unprecedented. Nothing like this has ever happened.
And I'm sorry, the Porter, that's the Willy Dee, right? The Willy Dee Porter.
Yes, the USS Willy Dee. Oh,
okay. It's like the US Willy Dee was stabbed. You guys ever see Spaceballs? I'm surrounded by assholes.
Yeah, that was this ship.
Yeah.
The entire crew of the USS Porter was placed under arrest and sent to Bermuda to face trial. Eventually, the crew did get off kind of easy, except for the one guy who forgot to take the primer out of the torpedo. They found out who that was.
Yeah.
So they all get arrested, the whole crew?
The captain, everyone. Everyone, the deckhands, all of them.
Yeah, just like it's just a sabotage. Like, what is going on?
The president was just shot at with a torpedo.
Everybody
from a US
who
Navy
forgot
ship.
To take the primer out of the torpedo got off easy. Do we know what happened to him?
Apparently, he spent, like, I want to say 10 years in some prison camp.
That's a hell of a mistake.
But yeah. apparently FDR called in and had his sentence commuted.
Let me ask you, so at this point, obviously, they just, like, decommissioned the ship and scrapped it for parts.
No! Oh, man, this is just getting started. Unfortunately, it wasn't the end of the Willy D's bad luck. The USS Porter was then sent away.
There's more?
Yeah. Oh, man. The USS Porter was then sent away to the Lucian Islands, where the Navy figured she couldn't get in any more trouble. They were wrong. During a New Year's Eve party, a drunk sailor aboard the William D. Porter accidentally shot a 5-inch artillery shell, which landed on the commandant's front yard on an American base in the islands. What are the chances?
Accidentally shoot artillery. You gotta pick that heavy thing up and load it in the gun and fire it. How do you accidentally do that?
I just want to know what exactly was going on the ship.
Awesome.
This was the 40s.
It's like being on the Porter was fun.
I mean,
around the Porter, not so much, but being on it sounds great.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like you go to Vegas. It's like, yeah, you can drink 24/7 and then, hey, you want to fire a machine gun and an artillery? Go for it.
They had this reputation that got around, you know, and so whenever another ship would come by, they would signal them and say, "We're Americans, don't shoot."
So at least they didn't live in war or anything, right? Like, I would assume that these guys were like, you know, all right, well, you're gonna be decoys. Like,
you would think they
go park you near an enemy and you'll probably accidentally kill some people.
You would think so. The Willy D was then sent to war against Japan during the Battle of Okinawa. Of course, nothing could go wrong, right?
Like, I mean, especially with Okinawa.
Yeah. So get this. During the conflict, the destroyer accidentally strafed the USS Lucy before shooting down 5 Japanese planes and then 3 American ones.
Oh my god! Just put it out of its misery.
I just want to know the chain of command during this entire process. It's like, you know, when your football team is losing, like, after, like, 3 games, like, yeah, we fired the coach. But it's just like, what? Happen? Okay. Well, just don't let it happen again.
Put him in a more dangerous spot.
Yeah, like they gave him more responsibility.
Yeah. Like, it's like, yeah, so, there's a small rock called Okinawa. You got this, right?
Yeah, we got a giant warship. Oh, we accidentally killed our own people. Well, they get pulled, right?
Well, in one final act of incomplete incompetence, the Willy D set its sights on a kamikaze plane heading right for them. The ship aimed, fired, and missed.
Because it wasn't a friendly plane, so they missed it.
The plane crashed into the water below the ship. The entire crew let out a collective sigh of relief. Well, until the Japanese plane exploded beneath the hull of the USS Porter.
I mean, that's usually what kamikazes do.
Yeah. So the explosion ripped into the side of the ship, and the Willy D began to slowly sink beneath the waves. Miraculously, though, against all odds, the entire crew survived. So.
Yay! I mean, look, I don't want anybody to lose their lives, especially at sea, because that's awful.
And everyone went to prison camps.
Yeah. No, I was just saying that, like, you don't want to hear anybody die, or especially soldiers, especially not at sea, because something about that just seems really awful to me.
I mean, especially in that. I'm just saying there were a couple. They might have slipped on a couple banana peels before that. And just...
I feel like there's probably a lot of banana peels in the hull. And when people would slip, it would make the, like, Looney Tunes sound. Like, right. Like that. Yeah. Bam! You know, like
yeah.
Whoa!
Pretty great
That's
stuff.
Pretty untouchable. But about 10 years before that, got an incident in the great country of Australia, the great prison colony of Australia, called the Great Emu War of 1932. So it's following the First World War. Many of the Australian veterans of that war took up farming wheat on the west coast of the nation. When the Great Depression struck, they were hit the hardest. And to make matters, you know, worse than, hey, you've just lost everything, the Australian government wasn't holding up their end of the bargain and skipping on their promised subsidies. So they weren't getting their 40 acres and a mule. They were getting half an acre and the mule's already dead. So that's when the first attack comes. Everything's falling to shit. Nobody's getting what they want. They're feeling slighted by their government. And here comes an attack. A formidable wave of 20,000 emus. That's right. The bird.
The ostrich.
They're not quite an ostrich.
Yeah.
The Australian ostrich.
It's like ostrich light.
They're shitty. Emus right? Suck. I used to live in a small town outside of Columbia, South Carolina, and one of the people out there had an emu farm. So a wave of 20,000 biting, honking emus migrated to the sea, swarmed the farmlands of Western Australia and decimated their crops.
Just with their dead eyes, just
at
full speed running at you.
They're fast as hell too. So they destroyed fences. They run amok. They eat everything in sight. So they're like the average Illinois person at a Golden Corral, like just plowing through people on their rascal scooters. No, but seriously though, emus, like flightless ostrich-like bird, up like a quarter of the continent.
Yeah.
All right, keep in mind, these are veterans of World War One, maybe the nastiest, most hardcore war that's ever been.
Yeah, we did a whole episode on how horrific it was.
If your feet are rotting off with trench foot, you're like in the lucky few. So these hardened World War One vets, right? Like these are badasses, and they're Australian too, so they could probably like fist fight a koala.
No offense, to my Australian friends, but you guys are savages.
So anyway, these World War One veterans have seen it all, but they're somehow hopelessly outnumbered and no match for these rampaging emus. So the government reclassifies them from protected species to vermin, and even put bounty on the emus' heads. Nothing happened.
I mean, they're tiny little bird heads.
Yeah, these little bird heads atop these long-ass, gross necks. And they went from like, hey, you can't hurt these things because there's not enough of them, to kill them. We will pay you. They needed backup.
I just love that the fact that they use the term vermin.
Yeah. You refer to them the way they would, like, you know, rats or cockroaches. Yeah. So anyway, they decide they need backup. And the Minister of Agriculture, he's straight up flabbergasted. He's like, this can't be happening. Yeah. This makes no sense. And so he and the Minister of Defense step in to take care of these rampaging, redubbed the Minister of the Emu War. I'm not making it up. This really happened. Sir George Pierce orders the Australian Army. He orders them to come in and take out these pesky birds. They called in the army to kill some emus. So Major GPW Meredith, at the 7th Head Battery of the Royal Australian Artillery, leads a pair of troops armed with Lewis machine guns and 10,000 rounds of ammunition. Right away is a short sight because there's 20,000 emus. So you need at least
Even close.
So 10,000 rounds of ammunition. Yeah,
so even if every single bullet is a kill
you
shot,
got half of them. and now you're outnumbered 10,000 to 3 by birds that are taller than you and presumably now crave revenge
and can run like 45 miles an hour.
So you're like 4 miles an hour.
Yeah.
They come in with all these the ammo and guns against the dreaded emus. November 2nd, they spot a group of 50 emus, but they're out of range. So with the help of some local settlers, they attempt to herd the emus into an ambush. But the birds, too smart for them with their walnut-sized brains, split off into two formations and outmaneuver their flank.
And ran away with their dead eyes.
Soulless. 2 days later, on November 4th, the soldiers engage the enemy. Again, I want to point out the enemy is birds. And manage to mow down 12 of them before their gun jammed, giving the remaining birds an opportunity to flee.
I'm not great at math, but I have a feeling there's a lot more emus left.
Yeah. So the major, he now devises a plan to mount one of the guns onto the back of their truck. But the cunning emu forces outran them on the rocky terrain. So again and again, these emus have seemed to outthink the military of Australia. And despite not sustaining any casualties, the Australian troops retreated with very little to show for it.
Could you imagine, like, the Australian flag is folded up and they knock on your mom's door and it's like, what happened? Emus.
Yeah, casualty of the emu war.
He was hanging out by an emu.
And I was like, I always knew he was a fruit.
Of all the things that could kill you in Australia, too.
Yeah, exactly.
So, all right. So, again, these emus seem to be outthinking the military. So, despite not sustaining any casualties, they retreat. They don't really have a lot to show for all the efforts they put in other than, like, maybe a dozen or so dead emus. So, the emus continue their assault on the veteran farmlands like oversized locusts. These fucking birds are eating everything. So, wave after wave, because they're still popping out new emus, too. So, you've probably already replaced the 12 you've killed and then some. The military launches a campaign. At this point, it's a desperate attempt to call these emu numbers. And although they've had greater success the second time around, the operation barely managed to put a dent in the onslaught of emus. And that's really the only way you can put it at this point, is an onslaught.
Onslaught.
You're still looking at probably 19,000+ flightless eating birds, just destroying everything. These badass birds, they refused to go down without a fight, right? So one particularly hardy emu took 5 bullets without slowing down.
It's like the Terminator.
The report filed claimed 986 kills with 9,860 rounds used, a rate of exactly 10 bullets per confirmed emu kill. Think about that for a second. 10 bullets.
That's a pretty hard headshot.
For every, yeah, that's true. So 10 for everyone. For the record, that's not very effective, you guys. Farmers again called for help in 1934, 1943, and 1948. This time, the army conceded defeat.
You win.
Defeat to the flightless birds that have been rampaging your western half of your continent for 16 years.
You win this round.
The war's not over.
Basically, anytime, to me, the biggest lesson here is not emus suck. It's when the Australian military joins your side in a war, that means literally nothing. So if like
we're going
to war with Iraq, it's war in Iraq. Australia's like, hey, we're going to join you.
Yeah, they just need
less than no help. You lost to birds that cannot fly away.
Then you just need to release some like raptors after them or something.
Well,
send in Demolition Man.
Well, again, I love bringing up The Simpsons for everything, but the Australian episode where Bart brings the frog, and they're like, oh, you can't bring animals in, so he just like releases it, and then by the end of the episode, bullfrogs have like taken over Australia.
It's like the dingoes all over again, right?
Yeah, you introduced like a non-indigenous species into like look at the pythons in the Everglades. They can't find swamp rats, rabbits, raccoons.
I gotta ask, why is this not a movie? Why is this not some big
budget
blockbuster?
Big Australia business is blocking it. I don't know.
Big Australia.
I just imagine this dramatic like Carmina Burana music playing as like this stampeding army of emus. like all these CG emus like coming over the ridge. You know?
Yeah. We're just like, hold your fire.
Yeah.
And it's the Jurassic Park effect of the rippling water.
Yeah.
What is that? Right. Hear that sound? What is that? It sounds like a rumbling, the occasional weird honking.
Then they have like a mounted machine gun. He's like, he won't go down. Not going down.
These bullets are 8 inches long, and I've hit him with 36 of them. He will not die.
Yeah, I could definitely imagine this trailer coming together.
Dude, if you look at some of the movies we get, like I watched The Meg on Redbox.
I still need
to see that. It's a movie about a giant shark with Jason Statham in it. It's unwatchable.
Really?
It's so bad. It makes Deep Blue Sea look like the first Jaws.
Meg actually read the book because
I keep hearing the books are actually pretty entertaining.
Yeah,
Meg read The Meg?
Yeah, exactly. Wow, Chris laughed way too hard at that.
That's well played. I'm
just clarifying there.
Yeah.
So, again, Australia 0, emus 1.
Sir, what is going on with your headphones over there?
It's on brand. thank you so much for joining us today, Devin.
Definitely. And I love this because I learned a lot. I know emus and ostriches are soulless dead creatures that walk the earth.
My favorite thing about that story is all the super deadly animals in Australia, like the sharks they have, and the jellyfish, and the snakes, and spiders, the saltwater crocodiles, and the super aggressive marsupials, and mammals they have everywhere, and the ridiculous heat and all that taken out by emus.
It's just, I'm glad that when I go to bed tonight that I get to imagine 20,000 demon emus going over a ridge and destroying my family. So, I want to thank you guys for,
of course,
enlightening me on that experience. But on a lighter note, there was corned beef sandwiches involved and there were morons on our Navy ship. So, it was kind of a nice little platter of just terribleness.
Just a sampling.
Real quick, if anybody wants to hear what an emu actually sounds like.
Oh, I would love it.
Just so that you can kind of imagine what an army of these things sound like coming over a hill. Hang on. This is terrific radio. Any second now.
Editing is my friend.
Post-production.
Yeah. Well, that was a bust. So it sounds like they're. Hang on.
I can find a clip. We'll leave that in.
It's like we're gonna get pulled off YouTube for copyright infringement.
We just promoted Domino's. They can't be mad at us.
Do you like flat rubbery pizza?
Are you drunk as
Is Pizza Hut closed?
Can you not get the Uber Eats
app? I can't get this Emu song to play, so we'll just forget I even brought it up. How's that? So, Devin, why don't you tell everybody where they can find your podcast, which is excellent.
Okay. Well, thank you guys. it's been a pleasure being here. If you want to check out my podcast, you can go to Pretend Radio Podcast on YouTube for right now. I will include download links, so if you want to put it in your phone, eventually I'll get back there. And Pretend Radio for Instagram and Twitter, which I occasionally go on. And also, if you're into punk rock, check out the Wastedist on
good band
on Facebook. The Wastedist official, just a local punk rock band, Jacksonville, Florida. We're coming out with a new album pretty soon on Rat Town Records, Surf and Turf. So look at Rat Town Records on Instagram to check that out. And thank you so much, guys. Got a little tongue-tied there, but thank you guys so much for having me. Yeah. I really appreciate it.
And then you can find the other podcast that Eric and I work on at comiczombie.podbean.com. And you can check out the other blog we work on at comiczombie.net.
And also, you can find all this on the World Wide Web.
www.http semicolon / / www.legendsofthehiddentemple.com.
Till next time, guys.